Okay, folks, let's get ready. All right, before I call the meeting to order, I do recognize that some of our members have other meetings to get to. If you have questions, I will bump you to the top of the list so you can get to other meetings if you need to. Just let any of the staff up here know that. If you want to write down your questions instead, we can do that. Because I anticipate a greater volume of discussion and questions from as opposed to yesterday's meeting, I would ask that you keep your questions and comments tight. We are on a time limit. We all need to be on the House floor at 11 o'clock. And again, any larger discussions that you need to have, that the members need to have with the director or any members of the game commission, maybe think about taking those to your office for meetings there. Just please be aware of, you know, and conscious of the time frame we have for this meeting and other members' needs. So on that, and in no means am quashing anybody's comments or, you know, that they want to talk about. I'd like to call the meeting of the House Game and Fisheries Committee to order. The purpose of this meeting is to hear and accept the report of the Game Commission. Are we hearing just from you today, Director? Okay.
Some colleagues here to help me with any of the questions as well.
Okay, thank you. We appreciate that. I'd ask the members to please hold any questions until all the testifiers have given their testimony. We'll be reserving any comments I have to later. And I would like to ask if my co-chair, Representative Maloney, has any comments to start.
Thank you kindly and welcome all. And let's get to the business of the sportsman. Thank you.
And we'll do a roll call now, please.
Representative Hohenstein. Representative Mirsky. Representative Boyd. Representative Cerisi. Representative Deloso. Representative Friel. Representative Gergely. Representative Giral. Representative Haddock. Representative Kazim. Representative McNeil. Representative Paelli. Representative Steele. Chair Kulik. Representative Devanzo. Representative Wentling. Representative Banta. Representative Cabell. Representative Dorsey. Representative Ecker. Representative Flick. Representative Kuzma. Representative Labs. Representative Maloney. And Representative Mercury.
If anybody doesn't know, Representative Mercury has been added to our committee. All right, Director, you're up.
Thank you. Well, good morning, Chairwoman Kulik, Chairman Maloney, and members of the House Game and Fisheries Committee. I am pleased to share with you what the Pennsylvania Game Commission has accomplished over the past year. First, I'd like to introduce, in addition to the senior leadership team that I have with me today, I have four of our Board of Commissioners here, Kristen Copenhaver, Alan DeMarco, Stan Kinnick, and Michael Mitrick, and I appreciate them joining us today. Our mission requires managing the Commonwealth's 480 species across 46,000 square miles and for more than 13 million people, both hunters and non-hunters. That's a huge challenge, but it's one that we embrace, as evident from the accomplishments by our employees, volunteers, and board members. I'd like to first talk about our efforts in protecting wildlife through the work done by our state game wardens. During fiscal year 2022-23, game wardens issued 5,567 warnings and initiated 6,911 prosecutions. The success rate for those prosecutions was 98.2%, demonstrating the professionalism, training, and judgment used by wardens when bringing charges. Last month, 12 new game wardens graduated from the Ross Luffler School of Conservation and were assigned to districts across the state, bringing our complement to 204 full-time wardens. 14 of those wardens are members of our woodland tracking team and are specially trained in conducting search and rescue operations in remote locations and across difficult terrain. The tracking team was deployed 22 times last year and even assisted in state police in searching for the convicted murderer who escaped from the Chester County prison last summer. For wildlife management, it seems appropriate to start with the white-tailed deer, and no other species generates as much interest and passion. Given the significance of deer to our hunters and the potential for deer to impact forest and agricultural industries, we take seriously the importance of maintaining a science-based program that uses the best available data. That's why we invest so many resources in studying our deer harvest, which recently has averaged around 400,000 deer between the various seasons. Last year, 31 teams of Game Commission staff visited more than 400 processors and examined more than 23,000 harvested deer. This work allows us to monitor the age and sex of harvested deer to understand their population structure and inform our deer management decisions. When it comes to bucks in particular, more than 60% of those taken are 2.5-year-old or older bucks, thanks to antler point restrictions, which a recent survey showed are supported by over 70% of our hunters. There are many challenges that our deer population faces, though, especially given the spread of chronic wasting disease, which continues to show up in more harvested deer each year. Together with researchers from the Pennsylvania Cooperative Fish and Wildlife Research Unit at Penn State and the Wildlife Futures Program at Penn Vet, we're conducting research in Bedford and Fulton counties to explore how CWD impacts deer movement, behavior, survival, and causes of mortality. But deer aren't the only species we manage. Last year, we wrapped up a 3-year study of adult female black bears on Sproul State Forest looking at habitat use and survival rates. The results will be incorporated into future season recommendations. Launching this year is an even larger research project that will take place over the next 5 years. It involves putting GPS collars on 200 male and female bears to learn more about their survival in relation to things like habitat and human presence. Likewise, we've conducted research on wild turkey populations. Working again with Penn State and Penn Vet, we're putting GPS transmitters on turkeys in different landscape types and following them to monitor their survival in the face of varying habitats, weather conditions, disease, predation, and more. Our counterparts in Maryland, Ohio, and New Jersey recently joined the study as well, which will give us a regional perspective on turkey populations. We are also continuing our efforts to combat white-nose syndrome in bat populations. Lately, we have documented some significant achievements in potential breakthroughs. We found that reducing the temperatures a few degrees within hibernating sites can reduce the growth of the pathogen, which is a fungus, which causes the disease. Based on this finding, we piloted a treatment program at the site that resulted in a 2/3 reduction in disease prevalence. Last spring, we tracked female bats in migration and found over a dozen new colonies that led to over 1,000 reproductive adult females now being monitored and protected. This really demonstrates the need for research and the benefits that research has brought to recovering these species. We're also studying the genetic diversity of grouse to learn more about how fragmented habitats impact their survival rates. And we're banding songbirds at Middle Creek Wildlife Management Area as part of a continent-wide effort to identify threats to the survival of various species. And yesterday, I'm pleased to announce, since about 1990, bobwhite quail basically extirpated from Pennsylvania. Now at Letterkenny, we had our media day. We were released bobwhite quail, and now that native species is back in Pennsylvania the first time in many decades. We're also working hard to create and preserve the habitat that wildlife needs to survive. Prescribed fire was used on almost 9,000 acres last year. Timber harvests improved habitat on nearly 25,000 additional acres. Some of those timber harvests involved a contractor paying us for the lumber, but for others, we removed the trees solely for the purpose of improving wildlife habitat. We added more than 3,500 acres to state game land system and made infrastructure improvements on existing game lands, creating and improving 55 miles of roadways and constructing 28 bridges. To give you an idea of the extent of our road system, our game lands, it would extend from Harrisburg to California and halfway back across the country, so it's quite a large road system within our game land system. We expanded the number of public shooting ranges that are available. We built 6 new ranges in the last 2 fiscal years and added 2 archery ranges last year, with another coming online soon and 5 more in the works. Multiple existing shooting ranges are scheduled for upgrades as well. We certified more than 29,000 new hunters through a combination of online and in-person hunter-trapper education classes, over 50 of the classes being held in public schools, thanks to the legislation authored by Chairman Maloney, which mandates that school districts shall make their facilities available for hunter education classes. We didn't stop there either. It can take time and resources to create a hunter, so we offered Learn to Hunt programs on pheasant, squirrel, spring turkey, archery deer, and firearms deer hunting to help recruit hunters. These programs initially consist of a live webinar and videos and then made available on our YouTube page where they reached thousands of new potential hunters. We've also made a point of going into communities where hunting is not as prevalent as other parts of the state. The 12-county southeast region, for example, is home to more than half of Pennsylvania's total population. But for those that live there, it's not always easy to find a place to hunt or a mentor to teach you how to be successful. In conjunction with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the State Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, we offer mentored hunts in Philadelphia at the John Hines National Wildlife Refuge and Benjamin Rush State Park as part of our efforts to introduce hunting to new participants and new communities. In doing so, we also demonstrated to public landowners that it is possible to use hunting as a mechanism for managing deer populations in heavily populated areas. We set records with Pennsylvania's National Archery in the Schools program, which saw over 300 schools and more than 100,000 students participating. In addition to serving as a training ground for the next generation of hunters and recreational shooters, this program helps students develop focus, discipline, and patience, skills needed to be successful at both the range and in the classroom. And speaking of the National Archery in the Schools program, we will be holding this year's state tournament on Friday, March 22nd in Lancaster County. There's a flyer in your packet you received today that has the details on this event. We would love to have you attend if your schedule permits. There will be over 1,000 students from across the state competing for individual and team awards on that day. But hunters and trappers are not our only constituency. We manage all wildlife for all Pennsylvanians and strive to provide them in ways to connect with wildlife and work done by our employees. We release podcasts and videos and expanded our presence on Facebook, Instagram, and X. And we talked face-to-face with Pennsylvanians at events like the Farm Show and the Great American Outdoor Show. Nearly 2 million viewers enjoyed our live streams showcasing a bear den, elk, snow geese, and bald eagle's nests. Through our junior game warden camps, we introduced hundreds of young Pennsylvanians to what it takes to be a state game warden, while internships opportunities give older students real-world experience in everything from wildlife and habitat management to biology and education. We offer driving tours on multiple game lands, giving people the chance to see some of the properties and interact with our staff. Each month, we distributed copies of the Pennsylvania Game News to approximately 4,000 libraries and 70,000 individuals, including anyone who took hunter-trapper education this past year. We participated in the statewide Envirothon and held the National Hunting and Fishing Day event in conjunction with Middle Creek Wildlife Management Area's 50th anniversary. All told, there's a lot to be proud of when it comes to Pennsylvania's wildlife and hunting heritage. We remain second in the country for hunting licenses sold, only behind Texas. A recent study analyzing hunting license sales found that the nationwide trend is for sales to decrease by over 3% per year. But Pennsylvania is an outlier, with sales remaining steady over the last 5 years. We constantly rank in the top 5 states nationally for a variety of deer hunting categories, including antler buck and antlerless harvest. We are recognized as a top turkey hunting state, with more hunters and more birds than just about anywhere. We have abundant small game hunting opportunities, thanks in part to our over 225,000 pheasants we raise and stock across the state. We continue to produce some of the heaviest black bears, some of the largest elk, and we monitor, research, manage, and create habitat for all species in between, from barn owls to wood rats. This concludes my prepared remarks. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the work performed by the dedicated individuals who make up the Pennsylvania Game Commission. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Okay, thank you very much. Chair Maloney and I will reserve any comments and questions to the end. So we're going to go right to our members so that they can get their questions in, comments in. Representative Flick, did you have any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Chair, and thank you for that testimony. Just a sort of an offbeat question about archery, and thank you for all the work you do with the school districts. Do you guys do any work whatsoever? I'm from the 83rd District, home of Penn College, which has a phenomenal record with archery. Mm-hmm. Do you do any work with universities at all, such as Penn College, in the archery sector?
Let me bring up Matt Moret. He oversees, part of what he oversees is our shooting program. Matt?
The National Archery in Schools program is in the build process. We have just entered into a division of shooting sports with the gentleman that headed National Archery in Schools since its inception here in at the Game Commission, and that division has just grown. So we, you know, our newest employee comes from the scholastic shooting world. So that is one of the ventures that we are heading into as we grow that campaign. But at this point, we are not involved collegiately to this day. But we're feeding a lot of that program through our National Archery and Schools program. Thank you.
And I'd like to welcome, we mentioned before, Representative McCurry is a new member to our committee, and he has joined us today. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Chair Kulik and Chair Maloney. I'm pleased to be here, and thank you, Commissioner, for the testimony.
Representative Hohenstein.
Thank you, Chair. Director, thank you for coming. It's always good to hear from you, and always good to hear about the programs that you're running. I know you're going to be getting some questions on some of the financial aspects of your accounting and auditing. I'm simply going to say that I stand with the members who are going to be asking about that. My specific issue, though, is focused on the change in policy regarding public contact with wildlife that was made last year. And we did pass a bill through the House that would address that issue. But I would like to know a little bit more from the Game Commission about what was the process and the rationale for changing a policy that had been in place for 35 years relating to how the public interacts with effectively wild animals. Why was that done? And what are the processes now to reconsider it? Because I think we've seen some troubling things happening in some of these menageries and roadside zoos and other places that were given a little bit more leeway under the current policy than they were under the previous one.
Okay, I'll ask Jason Dukoski, who's with our Wildlife Protection Bureau.
Yes, I believe this stemmed from last year at a board commissioning meeting, where a menagerie owner requested some changes after they found out that it was unlawful for them to allow a I believe it was a bitterong to have contact with people along with a type of kangaroo that they were taking to a nursing home. After the game warden told them that was unlawful, they approached the board through public public meetings and requested a change in regulation. So what happens then is that goes through the board, through their process. They come back to my division, which is dealing with law enforcement, and they ask for all the information as it relates to any other cases where we had issues where people that were hurt, injured, bit by animals under the menagerie setting. And we didn't have any records of that. So that is how the public process goes through regulation changes.
You're saying that you didn't have any recorded instances of any type of injuries happening to either animals or people?
That's correct.
In these settings?
And those settings. Now, keep in mind, we do not regulate AZA-accredited facilities, such as zoos, the large facilities.
Right.
We handle the smaller menagerie type of settings. And up until that point, we had a very, very restrictive regulations on what was allowed in those settings.
Right. And so you hadn't really had any incidents prior to the change?
Correct.
What has happened since?
I have not heard of any new incidents, such as biting, scratching, or any type of injuries as a result of direct handling of these limited species. Now, they can't handle exotic wildlife, which are the large cats, the bears, the canine animals. These are the smaller, I wouldn't say typical animals, but these are the ones that typically are used by zoos to get the word out, like a public type of thing where they get people involved with these smaller animals that will not hurt people. Bitterongs, small animals like that, you know, something that's about 25 pounds or less.
I would just, without disagreeing too much, I'm going to disagree a bit. It didn't cover just smaller animals. It did cover things like giraffes and kangaroos, and there are health risks even without significant injuries, because even a bite, a small bite or a scratch can be part of a vector, and without having vaccination in many of these animals, those types of issues and exposure for the public is a pretty serious one. I would just hope that is going to be reviewed and looked at a bit more. I don't know that it was proper to change policy based on just one owner coming to a commission and saying they wanted the change. It strikes me that it should have involved a little bit more in-depth analysis of the situation prior to such a significant change.
Thank you. I'm personally still trying to picture a kangaroo at a nursing facility and why that would be permitted.
At the time, it wasn't permitted, and that's when our officer had contact with that facility to bring them into compliance with the regulation.
Is it permitted now?
It is now, yes.
And we think that's a good idea.
That's not up to me personally.
Okay, thank you. Representative Dorsey, did you have a question? You're up.
Thanks, Chairwoman, and thank you, Director, for your time and testimony. I do have a question about the finances, so I'm one of those guys. So I'm looking at page 35 here of the report, and the fund balance of surplus, what I'm seeing here, as of June 30th of last year, is over $500 million. So my question is, what's your strategy and plan for these surplus funds?
Yeah, two things I want to point out with those surplus funds. The majority of those were earned by natural gas revenues that came in over about an 18-month period of time. The gas prices, due to a lot of reasons, were extremely high, and now they've come back down to where they typically are. But we do have a plan. One of the plans that we've had in place for years now is to make investments in infrastructure that will have benefit to the sportsmen and to the resource for decades and decades, to make sure that we're making those investments now for lean times that will eventually come. Number two, we have two new programs that we're rolling out. One is a private lands program with a focus on species of greatest conservation need and threatened and endangered species. We have a list of species that for a long time, and now we're in a position where we can work with private landowners, and usually these species are in trouble because they rely on very unique habitats. For example, rough grouse is a combination of both disease and habitat. And we only have so much habitat of public lands we can manage, but by managing, help landowners provide assistance in managing their private forest lands, we can create more habitat for those species, for example, the rough grouse. The second program, you know, Pennsylvania has about 700 shooting ranges throughout the state.
Frank, can you please speak into the mic a little bit?
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's
thank
okay.
You.
Thank yep. you.
Pennsylvania has about 700 shooting complexes across the state. Very important for us for recruiting new shooters, recreational shooters, and hunters. We'll be launching this summer a program to provide grants to those ranges to help them improve their facilities and expand their capacity to bring new shooters into those complexes. In addition, there'll be requirements that, for example, hunter safety opportunities, public shooting opportunities to introduce new people to new ranges.
Representative Steele.
Thank you, Chair Kulik. And thank you, Director Burhans, for that testimony. It was very informative. As a mom of four children, I want to share that I'm so grateful for the work that the Game Commission does in connecting children to the outdoors and working to carry on our great American tradition of robust public lands. But our family, like so many families today, is very busy. And I find that not being able to get out on Sundays is a major challenge for our family. So I'm curious about your thoughts on Sunday hunting, as Pennsylvania is one of the last states that still prohibits Sunday hunting, except for the three that we have in place now.
Thank you for that question, and we're very supportive of Sunday hunting. Several years ago, obviously, we were giving authority for limited Sunday hunting, and what we found was what we expected, that a Sunday's not like a Saturday when it comes to pressure. But for those that are taking advantage of the opportunity, and I've talked to hunters personally out in the field, sometimes that Sunday is the only opportunity they had. And for some, it doubles the amount of time they can spend in the field. Interestingly, we've had no issues with Sunday hunting over the past few years that Sunday hunting has been allowed. And our surveys show that Sunday hunting is one of the reasons that we've been able to flatten out the decline of hunters in the state. So it's been a wonderful opportunity to engage new hunters, keep them out there, even myself. Addition of Sundays doubles my time because they make me work Monday through Friday, so it's a great opportunity.
Thank you.
Representative DeVanzo, are you, do you have a question?
Yeah. Thank you, Madam Chair. And thank you guys, Brian, for being here and your testimony. My concern is our youth hunting, making sure that the tradition carries on from generation to generation. Your report here says that, you know, licenses, what are we, number two in a nation for the license sales. Is there a certain part of the Commonwealth that we're higher and lower in, or is that just a trend across the Commonwealth?
A trend across the Commonwealth, yeah. It's not by region. It's statewide. Our license sales have been pretty steady for the last several years.
Now, the license sales, is there a study that finds out that we're actually cashing in on the sportsmen coming out and actually hunting? Because I know lots of guys that buy the license and just that's the end of it, you know.
Well, even with hunter safety, I think the number I had in my head was about 20% of the students that come out of hunter safety actually purchase a license. A lot of that depends on opportunity. Do they have a mentor, somebody to take them out hunting? Of course, when you're 13 years old, you don't have access to a vehicle or anything like that. What's also interesting is the number of individuals taking hunter safety that are older than 20 years old. So we're reaching some of them. I'm looking at, you know, resident junior combo, for example, this year. You know, it's a very concerning area when our license sales, because although not down very much, it's not where it needs to be. And that, I think, when we look decades down the road, it's the number of new hunters we're able to recruit. Now, we've been having a lot of success with hunters that are, say, 25 to 35 years old. They already, you know, pretty established. They have transportation. And so we're, a lot of the conservation groups as well are having a lot of success with that age demographic. But it's always of concern of whatever, if we don't get enough hunters into, new hunters into the tube, your hunter numbers are going to continue to decline. So that is something why we've come up with a lot of these new programs, such as Learn to Hunt programs, to capture some of these individuals that are older, that are independent, and get out there and hunt. But we still need to continue to address getting new hunters out there. And it's very difficult in today's society. Pennsylvania and other states are facing that same dilemma.
Yeah. And the reason I bring that up is, you know, Westmoreland County, we have the same. I can go to that spot every opener, and I know who's going to be there.
Yep.
And these last 2 years, those guys aren't there. And they're not getting the bucks in archery season. They don't archery hunt. So I have a concern that, you know, when we went to the Saturday opener, there was a big push we're going to get our next generation out there. As I circle back with some of those families, you know, those kids were 12 and 13 years old. Now they're 15, 16. Mm. They're in a band over that holiday weekend. They're not hunting anymore. And when I followed back with the one father, he's like, hey, I lobbied you for this, and it was great for the 2 years. Now, however, we're out of the equation.
Mm-hmm.
Kids are there, and you know they're never coming back with it. So my concern is that we've kind of expedited the process of losing hunters by we got the young people that aren't necessarily here anymore, and the older folks, we've chased them away. And, you know, the guys that are 70 years old and they're mad about this, they're not coming back, you know. So I just want to see the longevity of the hunting stay here, and whether it is a Sunday hunting season, you know. Something, and just real quick on Chairman Maloney's legislation that we did in the schools, is there any interest in really acting on that at all? Because I think if we really are serious about making change, we've got to be 100% serious about it and really dive in to make the change, you know?
Yeah, we've been working with another organization as well. We piloted it in Western Pennsylvania to create basically an after-school program that would engage those individuals in learning about hunting and shooting and all those outdoor activities is one way we're approaching that. It's an area we're still expanding in and working our way through. I think the schools are going to be an integral part. You know, when I came up through school, hunting was normal. Now it's just not. And that's a societal change we're seeing across the country. That's very much a challenge, you know, to get hunting more mainstream. And, you know, when you look at societal changes, I often hear, well, they're on their Game Boys or whatever. You know, I think it's a little bit more than that. It's just, you know, we've become more urbanized and less rural. You know, I grew up in a very rural area of Montgomery County. You know, I walked out my backyard and went hunting, trapping. You know, it was very easy for me to access. Hunting access was easy. I knocked on doors. I never got turned down for a place to go. So things like access and opportunity and then having somebody. Admittedly, my father worked a lot, so you know, I kind of did a lot of things on my own, and that's probably why I'm such a bad hunter. But, you know, I had that drive to be a hunter. I always did. But I also had access. I mean, it was literally walk out my back door, and I had access to thousands of acres that provided that to me. So there's so much that's changed in the society. I don't think the youth have changed. It's all the challenges they face. Like, organized sports has been identified as a huge barrier to hunting because it takes up so much of their time. So there's a lot of challenges, and we don't have the silver bullet. We just continue to look at what's working, what's not working, and all the states are in that realm because we work together on this issue as a community all the time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Haddock.
Thank you, Chair. Director Burhans, I want to first start with a great compliment on the turkey program that's going on. You didn't mention that. I know you only have a few minutes with your initial report, but I think it's important that we note the turkey study that's going on in Pennsylvania and the in-depthness of that program, where we're not just leg banding, but we're actually putting radio transmitters on hens and gobblers and doing an extensive program. I was able to join in 3D recently, just a few miles from my residence, on one of the trapping events, and you know, we tagged 16 turkeys with leg bands, and 13 were placed with transmitters, and the very similar to the bear program, the information gathering from blood to the length of the beard to the weight, to the length of the spur, and the care of the turkey was really just phenomenal, and there was about 14 to 16 staff members and volunteers helping with that. So I think that's important to note, and I'm going to be interested following that, especially because I know you did it, in four areas, I believe, throughout the state. Mm-hmm. Maybe you could just give us a quick shout-out on that.
Thank you, and I'm glad you had an opportunity to join us. I myself love turkey trapping because you can use bait, and there's no bag limit. It's interesting that in the wild turkey research, what's going on right now, all the new things that we're learning about wild turkey research. Research comes in waves, and certain turkeys is a good example. There's a lot of new research right now. Pennsylvania finished its restoration, if I remember right, somewhere around 2003. As in every state, you see a large increase in turkeys, and then they start to decline, and then they kind of stabilize. Nobody can answer that question now, and we're learning a lot of new things about how wild turkeys operate that is probably different than when they were in the restoration phase. So this research is really important for us to better understand what challenges wild turkey populations are facing.
Okay, thank you. So we start off with something good. Now a little something maybe in a little different direction. I know the Senate in particular at their hearing talked to you about your paid lobbyist. And I know you testified that that program is going to end. And I've certainly had direct conversations with you many times about communication of the Game Commission to not only the legislature members, but the general public. If I have it right, the paid lobbyist is going to be leaving shortly, and you told within the next few months, and you told the Senate that you would do a report for them on how many, because they were supposed to help you with legislation, and how many contacts they made to the Senate. I would like to see that on how many contacts they may have made to the House side of things. And then the liaison today, Director, and you have the right to run your department the way you want to run it, but I heard a rumor, because I heard it out on the street, the hall, that our liaison has been recently displaced with internal operations. And you could certainly, can you confirm if that move was done?
Yes, absolutely. So we, with these rollout of these two new programs, which are going to be working with the legislature quite a bit, we decided to assign him to that new role to work with these programs because he is a very high-level thinker, and these programs are going to take a lot of work on the front end to make sure they're set up correctly and implemented correctly, and that we do the outreach with the legislature to engage them on these opportunities because these programs are going to be dramatically impactful in your local district, and we needed to make sure we had a person in place that could do that. And he's a high-level strategic thinker and the right person to do that.
Okay, but then who replaced our direct liaison? Have we made that decision yet?
No, those positions will be open, should be open this week. And,
okay.
And to come back to the question about the liaison, at the time when we were faced with really an unprecedented situation in House Bill 1300, which thank you to this committee for rectifying that. What was very important to understand is that was potentially catastrophic to hunters and the Pennsylvania Game Commission, more importantly to hunters, because it would have diverted money and not allowed the agency to be able to use Pittman-Robertson funds because we would be ineligible. That's a tune of about $40 million a year. But I understand the sensitivity, and I hear what you're saying. We're not continuing to work with that company. I think because there's a 30-day window in there of notification. I think the last time the contract ends April 1st. But we heard you, and we understand that sensitivity, and we're sensitive to that.
Okay, thank you. That leads me into my next question. I like to say the Senate liked to steal the money, and of course they say that it wasn't quite a steal. So a little different terminologies, but now you rolled out on a high level, with limited information, a plan to start grants and using basically the same pot of money that we protected last year, And we don't know. So, you know, you have a $250 million balance. And could you give us a breakout of where your reserve balance is? Is there a fund balance? Is there a reserved account? Because, again, with gas and oil, you know, there's supposed to be a strategic fund where we can spend some. And this year, if I have it right, on quick needed projects. And then if the gas ever stops, we need a legacy fund or a reserve fund. Where are we at with the reserve funds of the Game Commission and this new rollout then with this grant program to be going into private lands? I have some concerns, and I'm already getting the emails from our sportsmen that most sportsmen, I believe, hunt public lands. And now we're going to do something, which I'm unclear of, for the private lands. And I am a private landowner, very fortunate to be part of a great old former farm. And we do our own improvements. And I understand you're going after maybe invasive species. But how is this going to work where the Game Commission is going to start looking at improvements to private ranges and private lands? And then there's an element that I don't have a lot of information on waterway improvements. And I'm not sure what the correlation is with the Game Commission funds with improving waterways in the state of Pennsylvania to help us with our Chesapeake Bay. That should be done in the legislature. I'm a big advocate of the environment, and Pennsylvania has failed long before I got here, and I'm only here a year and a half. With the Chesapeake Bay, but you made a comment that you're going to help Pennsylvania meet their Chesapeake Bay commitment. And to me, I don't know, when we start talking about water, I think that's more in the fish ballywick. So can you explain this program and give us some more details?
Yeah, because that is a really good question. So let me go, there's a couple there. I'm going to have Dan Dunlop start making his way up because he can answer have him answer the budget issues. But to start with the private lands program, so we've always had a private lands program, as does every state wildlife agency in the country. When you look at when it comes to wildlife management, the extent, when I say the size of quality habitats, is very important for robust wildlife populations. Let me explain that a little bit further. When you look at how this program is prioritize, it's for species of greatest conservation need. So don't think about things like food plots or other things that we, as hunters, we may think about when we're improving lands. The reason these species are usually on the list is because they require very unique habitats, such as a grassland habitat or a specific wetland habitat, or a lot of the species are bat species that require hibernacular. So that's where we have this list. We want to get those species off the list. The concept is to keep common species common and not let them elevate into the threatened and endangered status. If you follow the federal legislation that's been going on for decades called the Recovering America's Wildlife Act, that's exactly what that federal legislation is directed at, is getting these species off the list so they don't end up on the threatened and endangered species list. So when you're thinking of habitat, we're looking at native habitat management. Invasive species may be part of that, but we've had private lander biologists in the Game Commission for decades that worked with private landowners to address these species, but now we never had funding to do the actual implementation. You know, it's wonderful to do a habitat plan for a piece of property. It sits on a shelf and it gathers dust. It doesn't do anything for wildlife. Our goal as a wildlife agency, as every wildlife agency in the country, is to move the needle, to make a difference, to take these species. That's why we invest so much in, for example, bat conservation, is to get these species off the list. The shooting ranges is a really good...
quick on that, sort of private land. So is there any correlation or any guarantee that if we spend this money on private land, it's going to be opened up for public access? Is that in the plan?
No, it's not. And there's a good reason for that, because it was always a barrier to that. Because, again, this is focused on the species of greatest conservation need, and that's why we're addressing it through this program. So the shooting range is another great example. If you look at where most of the Pittman-Robertson dollars, for example, the PR dollars come from, about 88% is the last figure I saw, is actually coming from recreational shooters. So recreational shooters are a very important part of conservation funding here in the United States. So by increasing the capacity in these ranges, you know, the industry has been a real strong supporter of the agencies really pushing more opportunities for shooters because they buy more ammo, they buy more guns. And the Pittman-Robertson Fund comes from an 11% excise tax on arms and ammunition. So the industry question is well, we're paying an 11% tax. What are we getting for it? So that's why there's been a lot of emphasis for years and years for the Game Commission on providing shooting opportunities to get people engaged to shooting. And it's also a segue to get people into hunting. Once they get comfortable using guns, they realize they're safe, they get trained, and hopefully we can make that segue into shooting.
And again, and I did hear a clip that there is going to be some kind of correlation, again, or direct tie to having private shooting ranges have some kind of public access. Again, the key there is public access.
Correct.
If we're going to use game funds, it just can't. So there is going to be a...
Yeah, you're just not handing money out. There's going to be requirements, and we're setting all those rubrics up right now. That's why our liaison was helping us with that again, because it's no easy task if you can imagine the different permutations of where a request for funding would be. But it's really a unique opportunity to really make some long-term investments and get more people into the shooting sports.
Okay.
And Dan, if you want to take the questions.
Yeah, so currently our available fund as of February 15th was $523 million.
Okay, but the breakout now. So we have $500 million, because if you look at some of your financial reports, it's at $253. So some of them are probably legacy funds or reserved funds. What is the breakout of that $500 million?
So that is actually all in the game fund. So it's one main fund that sits with Treasury in reserve. And then we have separate funds as well, which would be like... for constructions with DGS, we would have a restricted account currently.
So what is your total assets of the Game Commission then? If we have 500 in the reserve fund for a game, how much money are we sitting on?
I would have to get you a total that number for
you. And who invests the money? So now we have a staggering and great, absolutely. But I noticed in last year's presentation, I did not catch it this year, I believe there was like a $9 million loss last year in our investments. So who handles our investments, and how do you handle that? Because again, as a state agency, we should be in somewhat safe investments, whether it's bonds or various mutual funds or possibly cash and CDs in today's world. So who does the actual investments for you? Do you have another company you might use?
No, all the funding is within Treasury. Treasury has a short-term and long-term fund. Okay. And then we actually can say how much money to retain in the cash side or the long-term. And we try to maximize our revenue by putting more of the funding into the long-term.
Okay, so there was the treasurer that invests and decides what avenue she's going in.
Correct. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rick.
Any of our other members?
Good.
We're good. Okay. So, Representative Dorsey, sorry.
Thank you. So, point of clarification here. So, I'm looking at, again, page 35, and we have a total assets line of 544,782,000, and it was just answered that they weren't sure what the total assets were. Can you clarify that? Are there actually? So this is the game fund balance sheet. There are other accounts that have money in them.
Well, the restricted accounts are within the game fund.
Yeah. So the restricted accounts, everything is within the game fund, except for we do have a restricted account with DGS. That they actually retain, I think back in February it was about $34 million, and that was for building projects. So that was for some new office buildings that we had with them.
Okay, so the total assets then are in fact $544 million?
Well, we'd have to get you a total amount as of today to see exactly how much.
As opposed to June 30 of last year?
Well, as of June 30th, it was 544.
Okay. Understood. Thanks.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about one thing quickly. Last year, you rolled out the online license sales. There were multiple problems with that. I will tell you that I think all of us on this sitting here expect that that is not going to happen again this year. We all received too many, and other members of the House, not on this committee, received too many complaints about that. I understand that there are always kinks in technology, but we expect that that has been fixed, and we will not see that again this year, and we will not receive emails this year. And I know that that's a conversation the director and I will be having soon as to how that was fixed. But that is one thing we none of us want to have to deal with our residents again. So hopefully you've taken care of that. There are numerous other issues that all of us have that will be discussed. And for the benefit of anyone here from the commission or the board, there are a couple issues that need to be put to rest. I attempted to address one of these when I took the chairmanship. I feel as if it was not addressed and that my request was ignored. I don't want that to happen anymore. We will be keeping up with these things. And I know that I will have numerous conversations with the director and that that will be passed along to the commissioners and the board members. And I will reserve those conversations for future meetings so that we can continue this meeting. But please understand that there are a lot of things going on that the members of this committee are concerned about, and I fully expect that those issues will be duly addressed with the members. So on that note, I'm going to turn this over to my co-chair, Representative Maloney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, folks. I know this meeting could be rather long if taken upon all the issues that the chair just outlined to some extent. I've looked at the last year, as your testimony said, Brian, with respect to what you took credit for, and I'm glad for that. I'm glad for a lot of things that I think have not only come to light, but have maybe made a positive step forward. I always like to give credit where it's deserved. I know you gave a shout out about the schools, and questions were by my colleagues about the school. They often wondered about that piece of legislation that took 10 years. But I do think, if you think about that opportunity, and I know you know this, that with 500 school districts in the state of Pennsylvania and all those buildings, there's a tremendous amount of opportunity, which is what I've often spoke about and tried to sell. So I'm glad to see that some of that is moving forward. And, you know, as a former school director and a PIAA official, knowing and raising four children, I know the demands of a family. I don't need to be lectured. And my point for that is there's been tremendous conflict with time, but there's also priorities. And to me, one of the things about the Game Commission and the Fish Commission is, to me, they should be focused in their lane. I never have agreed to the merger of the two, just so you're aware of that. I never have agreed to the sort of the foggy communication, if you will, with the sportsmen. Now, I'm going to run down a few things that I think are very problematic to me and sportsmen that I hear from all over the state. And I am going to start with respect to the pie charts. I'm going to call some of this fuzzy math. You guys were given a tremendous, tremendous presentation by a young lady on the Saturday opener. And frankly, Brian, the presentation that she gave the commissioners was one of the best that I've ever seen by somebody who focused on something that was your data. And it clearly did not come out, and most of it is in this report, most of it showed that it did not come out to match your fuzzy math. And I think that's very problematic to the disrespect of the sportsmen, especially when they're relying on data and accuracy. I have your numbers. It was 60% of the people preferred Monday. You guys spun it completely around. I have your data. 1,200 pages of it. I dissected it all, and it's 60% versus 40%. In my world, that's a lie. It's fuzzy math at best. So when sportsmen wonder why, how do you answer them something when you say, well, that's really not the way it is? That's sort of a culture to me that has happened within this agency, going back before your time, Brian. Even your own pie chart adds up to 101%. I like that. I think it's very deceptive with respect to the 2.5-year-old deer. And then you have a total here that comes up to 101%. I've often talked to you about the habitat. I think it's interesting now. I know of a couple studies that were broken to me within your agency about grouse. Was always blamed on West Nile virus and habitat, always. National people have often said, these are the two things that we worry the most about. The habitat has always been something for me, former director sitting in your seat, used to mock a certain area of the state by saying, if a deer lived here or came here, he'd have to pack his own lunch because our habitat's that bad. Multiple times in my hearing. It's unacceptable. That's the habitat that the sportsmen are expecting to be increased or to be at least addressed. And when we have these habitat grants, look, let's make it clear to the public. This is a negotiation with the Senate because they saw an opportunity of money, and now we're going to come out with a grant on land that you pick winners and losers, which quite frankly to me is not the position of government agency. And if we're going to have money for private grants, why did we not do it on our own land? I mean, these are the things that bother me. The commissioners that are sitting here, there's a lot of issues. Long before some of you were here, it seemed to be a cultural problem. I never got an answer on the money spent to the National Wild Turkey Federation and the fact that you violated the code of the state by buying alcohol. Yeah. Why do the sportsmen get insulted to that extent? Why did they say, well, I couldn't do that? Well, that's because you don't count.
We can't. We can't buy alcohol. We did not.
But you did. Yes, you did. I have that data.
Please share it with me and I'll be able to follow up with the committee.
The antlerless tags going to over a million, to me, is more of the fuzzy math, where we mostly all know, those of us who have been around long enough know, that north of 80, the herd's been decimated. There's hot spots in the state of Pennsylvania, I'll be the first one to tell you, and I like it. I spent a tremendous amount of time in my tenure. Southwest has been my area where I've not spent much time at all. So I think when we talk about opportunity, we talk about a deer herd that's an estimated number. And you know I've talked to you about this numerous times. And I'm going to be clear to the people that are sitting in here. If you have no idea how many of your agency people disagree with the direction of this agency, you need to find out. I'm going to go to this culture that you guys got a tremendous presentation
by the wardens. And Brian, you're copied on these emails that came from your former liaison, threatening to take the trucks away if they gave them any grief. Now, I want to know from the commissioner's point of view how we continue to allow a certain resistance and culture of, you heard his words. You know what he said, I think.
Actually, I don't. I'd appreciate a copy of that. I'd like to review that.
Victimized. There is a lack of trust and willingness to promote a positive culture within the officer ranks. In my 15 years as a union official, I've never received the feedback and level of frustration that the majority of our officers are conveying. You didn't get that?
No.
Well, I'll see to it that you get it. I have it completely transcribed. I am saying to you now that this is an accepted culture within the Game Commission. The results, unfortunately, our good people are leaving at an unprecedented rate. Yesterday, we had tremendous testimony here on the Fish Commission of those with Act 120 who come, get trained, and leave. We're going to continue this? It's bizarre to me. Our new employees, the ones that are the most fresh in this agency, are quitting at an unprecedented rate. And that's because they refuse to accept the culture.
I've looked at the data, and that does not exist in the data that we have.
Well, it's just testimony I'm sharing with you.
Yep.
Okay? And you went to law, and the court made a ruling, and now you appealed it. So if you're not aware of it, you need to get to those who have it. So that's a cultural issue that, to me, I wouldn't expect us in any way, especially when you start your testimony out, how many citations were done, the seriousness of those violations, the success rate of those violations, and then those people feel as if the culture doesn't allow them to communicate or to even be appreciated. So for those who are present today, I think you should remember that. There's something else certainly came up. Many of you know I chaired the Motorsports Caucus. We did a tremendous survey on the economic impact. It's $2.5 billion to Pennsylvania. Not as much as, obviously, sportsmen, but a lot of those people overlap. You know that the news got a hold of a decision that was made on sponsoring a sprint car. So I had people coming to me saying, how do I get on that list? Is there any quick response to how people get that money?
They can come and approach our marketing department. We had that company. It turned out to be the state champion for the state in that sprint car series. Mm-hmm. A lot of great marketing. You're looking at images. A lot of great images there.
But isn't it true, Matt, it was somebody closely related to you?
No.
Okay. Daughter's boyfriend, right? Yeah. So the reason I bring that up is it's always about optics in our world. It always is. And just like the lobbyist, that man never came, as far as I know, never came to talk to anybody in the House. I never heard of him even talking to anybody in the Senate. And I'm going to repeat something that very man said in probably my second term here. In a hearing not far from my office, this is what that senator said. Hi, I'm Senator so-and-so. I come from the northwest area. I come from the restaurant industry. And our geography was always that we had more deer than people, but we no longer have any deer. That's a guy you hired. I got a lot of questions on this Martin introduction, just like the Fisher. And Brian, you said here last year that the only thing that you knew although it was a species that you said took the most hits of any other species that you remembered.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing that you knew that they ate was Fisher's.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you said.
No, it was the largest component.
Okay. Okay. So at least we know there'll be at least one survivor one day, right? Survival of the fittest? Since they eat themselves?
Well, that's not their sole diet. It was the most common
correct.
Item
but
in their diet.
But they're vicious predators, and you can't delineate those kind of comments when then you're going to say, oh, our habitat's bad. We have species in trouble like our state bird. But we're going to spend money to bring a animal back on that's been extinct for 135 years. It doesn't sit well with the sportsman. I agree. I don't actually see how you justify it. If you have a priority list in a family's budget, you have a priority list in a company's budget, you look at the needs and what you have. Yeah, right now you got flush with cash. I'll be the first one to tell you, as you know, I fought hard to save it and was very successful at it. Of course, I believe it's now, as we already mentioned, a way in which we're going to find another way to divert some of the money, which I take issue with. And I think a lot of sportsmen will, too. And Brian, we've had a bad image, which bothers me about this culture. We're the largest ethics violation in the history of Pennsylvania came down on a game commission. I knew that man, by the way. I thought he was a good soul. I think he is. It's the unfortunate part of decisions. And it's the unfortunate part of acceptance. You are in large part participating in decisions that were made during that time. But there's these ethical, cultural optics that continued for me to be a black eye. Somebody in your agency asked me a lot about what would I suggest. First and foremost, I would suggest respect to the sportsmen, and I would suggest that they be heard. And of course, you know that I proposed a piece of legislation that anybody can take it as far as I'm concerned. It's the end result that I believe would be the best. And I've thought about it hard. I spent a lot of time on it, and that would be that sportsmen would elect their commissioners in their regions. It seems to me that that's the way we operate. It seems to me that in an open republic where you democratically take a person to be your representative, that they would take part in that. And Brian, I know this might be an ugly part of your job, but I'm going to go to something that has become personal. And I know that a lot of the things that we do in this life can be our responsibility. I think of the movie Ben-Hur, when he went to his friend, who he saved his life, and he said, look, when I go up there, I'm your judge, but I'm down here, I'm your friend. And there's a part of that that we all have to do in this life with respect to decisions and leadership. The sportsman in Pennsylvania reached out to you to have a private meeting with a state representative. And as your own testimony that you mentioned in there around the 13 million residents of Pennsylvania, out of all those people, you invited somebody who is toxic, who has no place in Pennsylvania optics, professionalism, whatsoever. And my question to you would be, why was that person chosen of all the people in Pennsylvania?
I'm not sure who you're referring to.
Okay, that would be a Matt Argott, who you made sure was at the meeting.
Now, actually, I know who he is because he came and spoke to the commissioners about Saturday opener, along with his son. That's why I remembered that much of it. He reached out to me in an email, and asked if he could attend the meeting and where it was and what time, and I responded back to him. At that time, I had nobody else reach out to me and ask to be at that meeting, so I said, why not?
Okay. So you're also familiar with the letter that he put out of libel?
No.
Yes, you are. Our plan to rule the Pennsylvania Game Commission by Randy Santucci and Dave Maloney, put out by Matt Argott.
Which Facebook site is that?
Well, he sent it out on social media, and he also sent it out in email.
Oh, I don't know.
That was long before he came to your meeting.
I don't follow social media that much.
Well, it's interesting because I know you have your own LLC, right?
Mm-hmm.
Brian Burham's LLC, Leadership.
Mm-hmm.
How do you do that on PGC time?
Well, I don't do any. I've just set it up, and that's the
9 to 5. There's your website. 9 to 5. And
well,
you said earlier that you were 5 days a week except for weekends. Look.
Now, can I answer that question?
Sure. Go right ahead.
It's not an active website. It's a placeholder that I have. It's not something I market or give out to anybody. I never bothered to change the information because I don't use it. All I did was set up the website. That's it.
So let's just think about this. If somebody puts your name in or the game commission and a name comes up, and Brian Burham's name comes up because of the algorithm that sends them to your site to call you between 9 to 5 with your cell phone number on it and you're working for us, how does that work?
I don't answer it.
Oh, okay.
And nobody's ever called me because I don't do anything to the algorithm, to build the algorithm.
So for you commissioners that are in this room today, this is what I would tell you. You need to be convicted on what our image is, how these sportsmen are treated with insults, how your own FOP members are treated with their own testimony and all and same court hearing, because this doesn't help us. I would go on almost any program and project that you guys would have. Most of you know that of me. That's who I am. That's what I enjoy. That's what I want to see continue. That's why I've only ever done what I did in this legislative body. But if you want to be personal and you want to come after me, gloves are off. That's what I'll promise you.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
Could you share with me, not now, you don't have to, but email the 60% for the Monday opener, where that data came from?
Just sure, it's the 1,200 pages that I did on a right to know on you guys.
But where was that data coming from? That's just
your people?
Is it just the emails
people
we got?
People who
is
responded it to them randomly,
oh, survey, general comments,
whatever, but they contacted the Game Commission on the Saturday versus the Monday opener.
So what you're saying is then of the comments that came in, 60% were in favor of the Monday.
Monday opener.
Okay. So it's just of who wrote in.
And just so you know this, I've never taken a position. I think you guys all know that. But what I don't like is either fuzzy math, lies, or people who think that they need their 15 seconds of fame. That's what I don't like. And I think if it lands on your shoulders, Brian, you got to be the guy that addresses it, or else you have to get out of the way. That's the way I feel, because this has been something for me for over 50 years that I've been a participant of and very passionate about, as we all can be at some level. But I can only go by facts and figures and what I know to be true.
So when you say change things, what are you specifically referring to? Is it the social media posts?
Well, first of all, I think the culture that needs to change inside the agency is Elmerton Avenue, evidently. And all of the things that I refer to are real problems. You may even have people in this room that sent me some of these comments. I don't know. But what I can tell you, Brian, is this is deep. And that's why I bring up the fact that the political makeup that's somewhat of a paradox where, oh, politicians should stay out of this. What are you talking about? Who do you think elects Who's the representation? Where do we get the checks and balances? Where's the voice at? And I can't tell you how many negative responses I got to the last commissioner's meeting.
So
I didn't get one good one, mm-hmm. not one. I was looking for it because I would just say, hey, look, something positive here. But I didn't.
So just to go back to culture, I'm not going to comment on litigation, certainly not going to comment on personnel issues or anything like that. I will comment that there's always two sides to a coin.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. But my problem, Brian, is this. It coincides with what's going on with the sportsmen. It's exactly how they feel.
Question.
They're not listened to. It's a rubber stamp. It's where do we come into this? So on and so forth.
When you say no positive comments from the last board meeting, are you specifically referring to the tabling of the Martin project? Is that what you're...
No, I'm referring to the fact that they came there, I guess, quite a few of them. I don't know what the number was to talk about the Saturday versus the Monday, the numbers in this chart that show that you have fuzzy math, all of those things. And with respect to, I guess, the wardens who came and also testified.
Mm-hmm.
You know who one of this guy's friends is? This toxic individual?
Mm-mm.
A retired state policeman whose dad worked for the Game Commission, who says he has all kinds of inside information, just like this clown does. If that's true, where's it come from? Where's it come from? I'm the first responder guy. I'm the guy who believes that the people who are standing on the front line should be respected. But to have a retired state cop who has a dad who was in the agency, and then I get all, you know what he called me?
No.
I get it for you. Anyway, it was a, like an Obama attorney, called me and my like Confederates. Where's that bitterness come from? Like, why?
That's why I'm not active on social media.
This isn't social media, my friend. These are emails being sent to other members.
Oh, okay. I thought it was
this
social media.
This isn't just some random 15 seconds of fame keyboard warrior. They may be all of those things. But at the end of the day, words matter. Behavior matters. And if you want to come after me, that's okay. But I think it's embarrassing that that's your position or anybody's position. And if they want to work behind the scenes on the sportsman, all comes to light in the end.
Now, when you say your position, you saying my position?
No, I'm just saying you're in general.
Okay, all right.
That's all.
I'm here to work with you.
Look, Brian, fine. But I'm here to do my job. And I'm
Understood.
Here to represent sportsmen, and I can only give you the things that I know that are in the way. And when they do want to make it a personal, look, it's not so much about being offended. If you can't have thick skin in this world, then move on. But I also think if there's somebody obstructing us, they need to move out of the way. And whatever that is in that agency or wherever, it applies. It's disappointing to me. Very disappointing to me. Disappointing to me what I've heard in the last couple years that came out of Elmerton Avenue or come out of comments that are made, and just not necessary. Not necessary. We are supposed to be in a united front. I have an email that comes right out of your agency that says not everybody in the PGC is bad. That person's concerned that that's their image. I didn't write it. They sent it to me.
I will state unequivocally, we have amazing employees at the Pennsylvania Game Commission. Like I said before, there's always two sides of the coin.
No doubt about it. But as anybody in this room should know, I go back with the Game Commission before any of you people were involved. Before. I love what it is about. I love the people I've interacted with. I trained for Mr. North America with a warden. He helped me down in Montgomery County. He had a twin brother who I used to go on the bear trips with to help them get the bears through the check stations. It's a part of what I did for a long time. I believe in it, but I also don't like to see it fall apart. You guys recognize somebody as the Lifetime Achievement Award who was the most controversial person in Pennsylvania. Holy crap. He's the guy that said he didn't know the bear were the number one predator of the fawn. Come on now. These are things that are said and done. They're not positive to the sportsman. I'm going to leave it at that, and I'll provide you with anything I have.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Well, thank you so much, and I think all this conversation has raised some other questions from some of our members, and if it's okay with my co-chair, I'm going to let them speak. Representative Deloso.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Real quick, Brian, I'll be brief. Look, I was a longtime hunter. I haven't hunted in years. I used to hunt 100 plus days a year. I believe Pennsylvania should go open Sunday hunting. I mean, I hunted crows and fox on Sundays, and you know, there's so few opportunities in today's modern age to get out in the field, and Sunday's a great day to do it. That having been said, the Monday, you know, as far as the Monday opener goes, I mean, we can dissect that many, many different ways. I absolutely enjoyed, much to my wife's chagrin, but I used to run right out after Thanksgiving dinner and head to my place in Sullivan County on Thanksgiving Day. And, you know, in Millville, taking care of the firefighters, doing a tag day. And the Endless Winds Fire Company in Shunk, every year, pancake breakfast. And I understand their suffering. So, I mean, there's here again, that's room that I would, I'm very much curious because I get it from both sides. I get sportsmen that, absolute traditionalist, that want to go back to Mondays. And I have other sportsmen that send me emails that, you know, it's, you know, I could care less. I am glad to be in the woods on Saturday. So that's up for debate. And, you know, what else is up for debate is the, you know, the numbers of, I'd love to see how many DUIs are issued on Friday and Saturday night now compared to 5 years ago. How many broken marriages and how many fistfights amongst longtime friends. You know, we had a rule in our camp, no politics, no religion. It would ruin a friendship. It would ruin hunting season for everyone. And frankly, when politics and religion collide with good science and conservation, you know, it always ends up in a good fight. And I respect Chairman Maloney. I respect anyone that is dedicated to the outdoors in a way, in a manner that he is. I have a friend that's very similar to him. It's a dedicated hunter and a dedicated outdoorsman. And I generally support the Game Commission, but I have to say this. If, in fact, and I'd like to be kept in the loop on this, that our game wardens are being arbitrarily and capriciously disciplined or treated, that I will turn my teeth on the commission on. I am truly, as much as Chair Maloney is a sportsman, I'm a labor guy. And I hope that, as spoke about by the good chairman today, that's not the case. That arbitrary and capricious dictates, such as we will take away your equipment in retaliate, that I will turn my teeth on the commission on, and I ask, Chairman, that you keep me in the loop on that, and thank you.
Absolutely, and I'm absolutely in agreement with you. I've never seen that communications, and
well, you're on the email.
Well, I don't know why I didn't see it, because I didn't read it.
I'll make sure you get it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Representative Steele.
Thank you, Chair. Just a quick comment. I so appreciate your perspective, Chair Maloney, and I know you've spent so much of your life in this area and that your knowledge is extensive and robust. But I want to state for the record that my experience with the Game Commission, the incredible game wardens, the scientists that are there, has been very different from yours. I meet and talk with a lot of the hunters in my own district. Their perspective seems generally to be different from yours in southwestern Pennsylvania. So I just want to note that for the record. While I appreciate your perspective and your comments, my experience with the Pennsylvania Game Commission has been overwhelmingly a positive one. Thank you.
Well, just for the record, ma'am, maybe what you missed on this was that I have tremendous relationships within the agency and have for a long, long time. My perspective is the concern that that deteriorates. So I appreciate your comments with that, but I wouldn't want you to think, as some of these men that are in this room know me, wouldn't want you to think that I don't have a respect for what they do. That is my point, but I don't want to see it deteriorate. So thank you.
Briefly, Rev Paddock.
Thank you, Chair. And ironically, I saved the best for last that I wanted to talk about with the interest of time. So we'll go quick. And different people already talked about it, from Chair Maloney to, of course, Dave DeRosso, Representative DeRosso's strong union guy, and so am I. And I did the same line of questioning with the Fish Commission just yesterday. The openings in our wildlife management, law enforcement, the different titles, you know, game warden is my favorite. So, looking at 10 years of the budget, it was about $10 million, and now we're at $13 million on expenses, and you did start with the work of the game wardens. But throughout Pennsylvania, we are having a problem filling many type of jobs, and one is law enforcement. And I do believe and cherish the work that they do, and it's a vitally needed. Well, most of the sportsmen are fantastic people. Some others are non-sportsmen and aren't. So we need to protect our animals, and that is the main, and education. Of course, they're also good public servants out in public to do goodwill. But I do know that, we just did a couple of good moves for the culture of working in the Game Commission agency, that we have some good news, especially in the wardens, where we're adding on to the training facility. And I think in the whole Game Commission, I believe you just hired a new position to help with interviewing and recruitment, mm-hmm. and hopefully some surveys to the staff, not just with our wardens, but all the Game Commission staff, because land management, of course, is equally important. So could you tell us where we're at with openings in the mm-hmm. game wardens, the class that was just applied for, I believe we just closed, or is it still open? And, the things we're doing to help the wardens first, and then this new position to help the culture of the Game Commission and the staff.
All right, I'll try to remember all those questions, but those are all great questions.
It's all personnel, but
as of March 7th, total district vacancies is 27. We've been running back-to-back classes. One of the biggest challenges we have as an agency, Fish and Boat faces this as well. Unfortunately, our compensation can't compete with other law enforcement agencies. Given that they're required to go through 44 weeks of intensive training and the amount of skills that they have, we're not competitive. Those aren't set by the agency. They are set by the Commonwealth Executive Board along with the Office of Administration through collective bargaining. So it's not like I, as director, can do anything about that. That's the way that process works.
Excuse me right there. That's a great point. So legislatively, there are some things possibly we can get done to help that, because, again, as a small town, former small town mayor, my borough that I used to be mayor at is paying, and we are the low in the area, and I think I have that right, at about $45,000 for new law enforcement officers in the town of Avoca. Some of our neighboring towns are paying much more.
Yeah.
And even at 65 in the area, that's low to some other areas. And we're starting our staff at a what? Same issue.
Yeah, it's what, low 40s, Jason?
And the nature of this beast is they just go into other fields because of the pay.
I was at a funeral for one of our officers on viewing on Sunday, and unfortunately passed away from, but had another, watched another officer come up to him and says, yeah, I went to the graves, referring to Pennsylvania State Police, you know, because, you know, although everybody has their different value systems, you know, and but people have to provide for their families. And there's nothing wrong with competitive pay and still being, have allegiance to the wildlife resource. They're not mutually exclusive concepts. And having fair pay is really important. And it's something we've been concerned with for some time. And we'd like to get our officers up and be competitive with other law enforcement agencies. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So this is, so in our marketing department, we hired in somebody, he came from the private side, who have expertise in recruitment. Last year we had about 340, Jason, applications. This year we had over 1,300 applications with that strong recruitment effort. Now, there was one other thing that we changed in there. You probably saw the governor's recommendation to remove college requirements from there, which we did. But it was really the recruitment aspect of it, I think, made a big difference in getting more of those people. And that's fantastic because, you know, the more applicants you have, the higher quality individuals you're going to end up with at the end of the day. And it's been tough. Last class, we only graduated with 12. That's tough. It's a lot of work for just those 12. So we're hoping we'll have a 4 class going through and we can get these vacancies caught up. Yeah, our plan there is to, you know, work with Fish and Boat because I can train our officers and their officers for the same amount, just run them through. There is differences in their training as far as the specialties, but a lot of the law enforcement would be the same so they could run. What I like about it, they work together now in so many different ways, but then they'll be able to kind of – so game wardens, when they go through the Ross Leffer School of Conservation, they even refer to themselves as litter mates. So there's that really bonding that goes on through that school, and I think this also promotes an opportunity for the fish side and the game side to form that bonding, because then they're going to be working with each other in the field. So it'll reduce costs, you know, have the training, make maximize their effects of their training, get them through. So I think it'll be a great opportunity.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? All right, then this meeting is adjourned. Thank you for your testimony today.